Good afternoon. On behalf of President Faust, Glenn Hutchins, and Henry Louis Gates, Jr., it is my pleasure to welcome our 2015 W.E.B. Du Bois medalists. Let us pray. O God, on this magnificent occasion, we thank you for the opportunity to celebrate those who have dared to change the world, to grasp whole of life as rendered and paint upon it life reimagined, more beautiful, more just, more loving. And so for the gift of talent and the mastery that comes with discipline, we thank you. For the exercise of courage, we thank you. For the commitment to education, we thank you. For hearts inclined towards generosity, we thank you. For a passion to champion the cause of those most ostracized, least cared for, and cast to the wind, we thank you. We know that it is you who grants us both to will and to do of your good pleasure. And so tonight we celebrate the work that you are doing through these, your men and women servants. Help us all to grow from their example. Amen. Amen.
My name is Glenn Hutchins, and I would like to welcome you to the third annual Hutchins Center Honors. Today we have a remarkable slate of awardees. And I want to thank them all for taking the time out of their busy lives to be with us today. Thank you for making the effort, especially on this stormy day. In addition to those who are on stage, we're also awarding a medal to Muhammad Ali, whose deteriorating health prevents him from traveling these days. But as we present the award to him in absentia, I want you to try to imagine not just him floating like a butterfly and stinging like a bee, for those of us who were big fans of his, but also fearlessly and selflessly agitating for social change and progress. He is truly one of a kind. I also like to thank President Faust, Dean Smith, as well as Alan Garber. I know Mike and Dean Alan are right here in front of the audience. Their presence today symbolizes their sponsorship of African and African American studies at Harvard. They truly understand that the study of people of color is not peripheral, but rather is central to a liberal arts education in the cosmopolitan, diverse world of the 21st century, where one can cross the traditional boundaries that's between us at the speed of light. Drew, Alan, and Mike, thank you for your ongoing and unflinching support for the African American Studies effort at Harvard. I would also like to thank the members of the advisory board of the Hutchins Center, who are our most important supporters, many of whom are with us today. Would you please stand in the audience so we can give you a round of applause? Come on, stand up here. We also have a surprise group of guests today, the five-time Ivy League champion Harvard basketball team. Where are you guys? All right. There we go, up here. Five-time champion. Tommy, thank you for bringing the guys out today. And I heard you guaranteeing a sixth championship out in the lobby. Anyway, thank you guys for coming. Today's program will proceed largely as it has in the past. In order to move expeditiously through the proceedings, we're not going to introduce the presenters, but you can identify them in the programs that were passed out as you entered the theater. Also, the award presentations will be interspersed with readings from W.E.B. Du Bois, as well as a video about Muhammad Ali, and we'll end with a song from the glorious Kuumba singers. So, without further ado, I would like to get the show started by introducing our first speaker, the redoubtable university professor, Henry Louis Gates, Jr., who also happens to be the director of the Hutchins Center.
Thank you, Glenn. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Look at the array of talent on that stage. Give it up. Give it up for the Du Bois medalists 2015. Madam President, ladies and gentlemen, gives me an enormous amount of pleasure to welcome you this afternoon to the third annual Hutchins Center Honor. Now today, we'll confer upon the distinguished individuals gathered on this stage the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal, Harvard's highest honor in recognitions of contributions to African and African-American history and culture, and more broadly, of contributions to human rights and intercultural understanding. The medal is named in honor of William Edward Burghardt Du Bois, first black person to earn a PhD from Harvard, a key founder of the NAACP, one of the founders of the modern civil rights movement, and arguably the greatest black intellectual ever to put pen to paper. Now, you'll hear about each of this year's recipients as the afternoon goes on, so all I'll say to them at this point is this. We are honored and thrilled by your presence with us today here in the historic Sanders Theater at Harvard University. Again, let's give them a warm Harvard welcome. Now, last year's Hutchins Center Honors, you may remember, marked the grand opening of the Ethelbert Cooper Gallery of African and African American Art. Our beautiful new gallery, funded by my Yale classmate, Ethelbert Cooper, with the strong support of Dean Michael Smith, situated in the heart of Harvard Square, beneath a gorgeous facade designed by the brilliant Ghanaian architect David Ajay, realizes a dream that we long have had to establish Harvard as the premier site in the entire academy for both the study of African and African-American art. The Cooper Gallery, with a growing, spectacularly beautiful permanent collection funded by Gallery Board Chair Richard Cohen and so ably administered by Vera Grant, makes that dream a reality. The Cooper Gallery works in partnership with the other research units within the Hutchins Center, the W.E.B. Du Bois Research Institute, Marcyliena Morgan's Hip Hop Archive, Alejandro de la Fuente's Afro-Latin American Research Institute, Evelyn Hammond's Project on Race and Gender in Science and Medicine, Ingrid Monson's Jazz Research Initiative, Vincent Brown's History Design Studio, David Beinman and my 10-volume Image of the Black in Western Art series, Alejandro's magazine Transition, Lawrence Bobo's journal, The Du Bois Review, and William Julius Wilson's newest research endeavor, The Anti-Poverty Project. And together, these research institutes and journals combine to make us the place to explore, question, interrogate, and celebrate the black experience globally in every discipline and every art form. And all that we are able to do here is made possible by the vision and generous philanthropy of Glenn H. Hutchins. Give it up for that man right there. And with the unflagging support, as Glenn said, President Faust, who's a great scholar of our subject, along with the support of Dean Mike Smith and Provost Alan Garber. Give it up for the administration, please. Thank you. Now, ladies and gentlemen, despite the triumphs of the past year, we can't deny that it was also a most bruising as any in recent memory, to tell you the truth. Tragic deaths of Michael Brown, Tamir Rice, Eric Garner, Walter Scott, Freddie Gray, Sandra Bland, the Reverend Clementa Pinckney, and the other eight victims down in Charleston, as well as others too numerous to name, but whose lives and sacrifices matter no less, those deaths shocked us all. At the Hutchins Center, we've been thinking a lot about how to respond. In August, our annual Hutchins Forum on Martha's Vineyard took on the subject of millennials. They rock, but can they rule? We gathered a group of individuals who can no longer wait, young activists who march, tweet, advocate, and protest in order simply to save lives that matter so deeply to those of us whose pleasant task it is to teach and study the history of peoples of African descent all throughout the diaspora. As were so many who came before, they have been called to action by the grueling inequalities that seem to grow more vivid every day, despite the significant and stunning advances we as a people have experienced. What inequalities? Inequalities in education, in wealth, in justice, health, political representation, and the safety of day-to-day living. My concern is that the end of the second Reconstruction is upon us now, or that there are too many in power who are trying to achieve that pernicious end. Du Bois said of the beginning and end of the first Reconstruction, and I quote, "The slave went free, stood a brief moment in the sun, then moved back again towards slavery. The whole weight of America," he continued, "was thrown to color caste. The colored world went down. A new slavery arose," unquote. Following the first Reconstruction, which of course was that decade after the Civil War in which the Union was to become whole again, the decade in which the slave was to become free, the decade in which property was to become citizen, the economic relation of slave to master was essentially reconstituted through a system of sharecropping and disenfranchisement, mounted mischievously at first in fits and starts, and then confirmed and maintained as the law of the land. As the great Du Bois again put it, and I quote, "The most magnificent drama in the last 1,000 years of human history is the transportation of 10 million human beings out of the dark beauty of their mother continent into the newfound El Dorado of the West. They descended into hell, and in the third century, they arose from the dead. In the finest effort to achieve democracy for the working millions which this world had ever seen. It was a tragedy," Du Bois says, "that beggared the Greek. It was an upheaval of humanity like the Reformation and the French Revolution." But he concludes, "We fell under the leadership of those who would compromise with truth in the past in order to make peace in the present and guide policy in the future," unquote. The legacy of the ending of Reconstruction, the redemption of the Confederacy, the redemption of the South, was a debilitating blow to the status of the newly freed slave and to their descendants. Sharecropping, convict lease, actually both forms, we might say, of neo-slavery, Jim Crow and lynch laws, poll taxes, literacy tests, and the audacious sanctioning of separate but equal as the law of the land by the United States Supreme Court. These are just some of the items in the catalog of horrors that kept the majority of black people separate and decidedly unequal throughout the first half of the 20th century. Still, miraculously, many of our ancestors persistently rose, and stories of success were beacons of hope and a promise of better days to come. The brilliant strategy of leaders such as Du Bois and Charles Hamilton Houston, Ella Baker and Fannie Lou Hamer, Vernon Jordan, Constance Baker Motley, Stokely Carmichael, and John Lewis, Malcolm X, and of course, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., worked in their various ways to get us in the mid-60s to what many of us call the Second Reconstruction, ushered in by the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Affirmative action would follow, and the numbers of those black people entering the American middle class swelled, educational opportunities increased, and it seemed that finally, ladies and gentlemen, we were poised as a people to arrive on the threshold of full American citizenship with all of the rights and duties that that entails. We know this afternoon that that isn't the full story. As this second Reconstruction of rights and opportunities in the late 60s and early 70s began to take off, work disappeared. Work disappeared from urban centers, as our colleague William Julius Wilson has so cogently demonstrated, and black unemployment and underemployment rose. The black achievement gap widened. The incarceration of black men became massive. Public schools became increasingly segregated, something no one in the 60s could have imagined. And discriminatory practices in the workplace and on our streets continued to affect countless black lives, both at the level of macro and microaggressions. Still, we rose, and still we could vote, thanks to the Voting Rights Act. And eventually, that glorious night which neither our ancestors, those many thousand gone, nor we, my generation, their heirs in faith and struggle, could ever imagine living to see. The night that we, the American people, elected an African-American president of the United States, a black man. And now he and his lovely family so gloriously and so elegantly occupy the White House for all the world to see. But what has changed And what is most frightening is that we see our legislative and judicial branches of government slowly and methodically chipping away at the rights that were so hard won. Supreme Court's ruling in Shelby County v. Holder comes to mind. And in our viral world of social media, we see unarmed black people being brutalized by some members of our police forces in ways that call to mind images of the violence wreaked upon protesters in the worst days of the civil rights movement, just as we witnessed the stubborn persistence of black-on-black homicide. So, as we find assaults on the second Reconstruction proliferating, we still have to stand boldly, ladies and gentlemen, say loudly and proudly that our history of struggle in this country matters, that the defense of voting rights matters, that the right to a job with a livable wage matters, that the right to decent housing in integrated neighborhoods matters, that the right to a superior public education matters, that the right of access to affordable health care matters, that the right to live in safe neighborhoods free from the threat of random murder matters. And indeed, ladies and gentlemen, black lives matter. What unites our medalists this year, who come from fields as disparate as music, education, finance, art, law, journalism, business, and especially boxing, is their commitment not only to the ideals of justice and equality, but also to the practice of justice and equality. They represent both the triumphs of the work that has been done and the vastness of the work that needs to be done. And they show us that that work can be as beautiful, as fulfilling, and as ennobling as it is necessary. Ladies and gentlemen, before we begin our ceremony, give it up once again for the 2015 W.E.B. Du Bois Medalist at Harvard University.
Good afternoon. What a special honor it is to present the first W.E.B. Du Bois Medal of the afternoon to Eric Holder, the 82nd Attorney General of the United States, and, in President Barack Obama's words, a good man. At class day in 2012 at Harvard Law School, General Holder, because that's what we call him, told our graduates that the highest goal they could reach for was, and I quote, not merely to serve clients or to win cases, but to do justice. Their education had prepared them to lead, to serve, and to give, and also, and I quote, to have faith that transformative change is possible. General Holder's career exemplifies this ideal. A graduate of Stuyvesant High School in Brooklyn. Somebody? All right. Columbia University and Columbia Law School. He clerked, all right. He clerked at the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. He took his first job at the Department of Justice and held positions as a U.S. Attorney General for Washington, D.C., Associate Judge of the Superior Court of the District of Columbia, Deputy Attorney General, and eventually he became the first African American to occupy the U.S. Attorney General's office. And I say occupy. It's a role he had performed with distinction, with strength, with courage, and grace for 6 years. Now a partner at Covington & Burling, where he worked for 8 years before becoming Attorney General, he carries into private practice his expertise in regulatory enforcement, criminal justice, and national security, and his ongoing commitment to justice. Many people, including our host this evening, Henry Louis Gates Jr., considered General Holder, and I quote, the moral compass of the Obama administration. Professor Gates has said of General Holder, he stood up for the law, the truth of the law, the racial complexity of America.
and he stood up for the Voting Rights Act. General Holder's priorities while Attorney General show a man committed to transformative change and the work that it entails, defending the president's health care reform, advocating for equal marriage, espousing immigration reform, committed to changing the criminal justice system, and fervently opposing the recent and ugly chipping away of voting rights. In the matters of race, General Holder has not turned away from the imperfections of our criminal justice system. After the events in Ferguson, he did not speak around race, he spoke about it. And in so doing, he made the strongest of cases for investigation, soul searching, for truthful, in-depth investigation and change. Upon leaving the Attorney General's office, General Holder said, and I quote, "We've always examined ourselves and determined that that which needs to be improved, that which needs to be maintained, and that to which we should aspire. This spirit initially led to revolution and then to the removal of the sin of slavery, the right of women to vote, the great civil rights movement that truly transformed our nation, and now a recognition of the rights of all Americans regardless of sexual orientation." I also salute his commitment ongoing to access to justice. I am honored to present Eric Holder with the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal for his dedication to the ideal of law as protective, as transformative, and to his unfaltering willingness to do the hard work that is required to redeem the promise of justice. All right.
My man.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Well, it is quite an honor to receive this award in the company of such great men and women, many of whom I know, all of whom I have admired for a great deal of time. And if I can take just a personal point of privilege, I took some pictures with Nas before I came out here. My level of coolness, an assessment of coolness by my kids, goes up 1,000% as a result of that. He's just another guy from Queens, though, the two of us. But it is an honor for me to receive this award, named for the person who laid the intellectual and historic foundation for all the progress that was made in the 20th century. It's also an honor for me to receive this award from Skip Gates and Glenn Hutchins, two people who I think are continuing the work of W.E.B. Du Bois and doing it in a way that he would be proud of. I didn't turn off my phone. That would be the Temptations since I lost my baby. The coolest phone ring. And I also want to say the Harvard basketball team, we were up there? Columbia's coming after you all this year. Nah, we got two dudes coming back. We got y'all. See you at 116th Street and Amsterdam Avenue. But seriously, the honor is for me a singular one. It's a recognition of the work that we've tried to do in the Obama administration and which is ongoing. The fight for LGBT rights, the desire to reform our criminal justice system, and to make real the promise of our democracy by ensuring that every person in this nation has the right to cast a ballot unimpeded. These are the things that animated my time as Attorney General, and I thank the President for giving me that opportunity, and I thank you all for recognizing the work that we did in the administration. Thank you all so much.
Marian Wright Edelman is the nation's leading advocate for children, a distinction earned through 50 years of ardent service. As founder of the Children's Defense Fund, she has developed something of a reputation for toughness and she does not apologize. And I quote her, "I'm inflexible about children being killed by guns. I am totally intolerant and inflexible about children going hungry in the richest nation on earth, about children being homeless, about children being in schools that don't teach them how to learn." Brought up in South Carolina, Edelman took to heart the words of her father, a Baptist preacher, "If you follow the need, you'll never lack for a useful purpose." After graduating from Spelman College and Yale Law School, she became the first African-American woman admitted to the Mississippi Bar in 1963. Not an easy year to be an African-American woman or man in Mississippi. There, she interned with the NAACP Legal and Educational Fund under the tutelage of Jack Greenberg, and went on to establish the Jackson office. Mississippi generated a number of formative experiences, perhaps none more so than the sight of Robert Kennedy trying to rouse a hungry and lethargic baby while on a tour of the Mississippi Delta. A powerful image of some of the forces that have driven her work for the last half century. Edelman's founding of the Children's Defense Fund in 1973 grew out of her work on poverty with Martin Luther King Jr. as a counsel for the Poor People's March. Her leadership of the Children's Defense Fund ever since has put her on the national stage as a forceful advocate for equal opportunity for education, decent housing, good nutrition, and employment. She strives towards the ideal expressed by CDF's goal to ensure every child a healthy start, a head start, a fair start, and a safe start. Her service has been recognized with awards including the Presidential Medal of Freedom, a MacArthur Foundation Genius Award, and I'm proud to say an honorary degree from Harvard University in 1991. She is a prolific author of books and essays and has written a regular column for the Huffington Post since 2007. She currently focuses on initiatives that bring together top thinkers in education, social services, and policy to remove the obstacles that stand in the way of the health and achievement of children of color. A servant leader of the highest order, she inspires us all to see that education is the best path out of poverty, and that it is the job of each of us not only to clear, but also to forge those paths for all members of our society. For her tireless commitment to provide a good start for all children, it is my honor to call upon Marian Wright Edelman to receive the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal.
Thank you so much. Glenn Hutchins and Skip Gates and President Faust, thank you for that wonderful introduction. I'm just honored to be here with these other honorees. This is like a celebration party. It's really wonderful. Thank you. An anonymous sage said, "Everything we need to learn in life, we can learn from Noah's Ark." And the first lesson from this sage was, "Don't miss the boat." And the United States is going to miss the boat to the future to lead this world if it does not begin to invest in all of its children. The majority of all of our children of all races cannot read a computer at grade level in fourth, eighth grades, and we all know what the dropout rates are. 74% of our young people, 18 to 24, cannot get into the military. Am I not speaking into the mic? Sorry about that. Because they've got a prior incarceration, they've got health problems, they are not they can't meet the literacy requirements. This is not going to put us in good stead in the future. The second lesson from this age was we all are in the same boat. And there are a lot of people who cannot stand the browning and blacking of America, and the majority of our children are now non-white. But we may need them, we will need them, and the American dream encompasses them. And 80% of black children and almost 80% of Latino children, who are a majority now of our babies and a majority of our school population in the beginnings, cannot read or compute at grade level in fourth, eighth grade. And we know about the cradle to prison pipeline. And what are we doing in grinding up the seed corn of our future? We need every one of these children to be educated and healthy and to be included in our dream, and we neglect them at our peril. The third lesson, quick lesson, is don't be afraid of criticism. And we all have to get out of our comfort zones. I mean, we've just got to, I'm sure everybody thought that Noah was crazy when he was building that ark, but you know, he went ahead and did it anyway. And if you don't want to be criticized, please don't do anything, be anything, or say anything. But we really all have to be at this critical period of going forward or going backwards. Get out of our comfort zone and speak up for the voiceless and the poor. And all of them are going to be a part of the quality of America's future. The fourth and my last one, which I like a lot, is don't ever forget that the Ark was built by amateurs and that the Titanic was built by experts. So many of us. We cannot sit back and think these problems are going to be solved in Washington by the politicians. They're our representatives, make a lot of noise, hold them accountable. We cannot expect the experts to resolve the issues of poor children in the Mississippi Delta of hunger. We've got to get out there and make our voices heard and build that movement. Movements don't come from the top, they come from the bottom. We're all sitting around waiting for Dr. King to come back. He's not coming back. And Dr. King, whom I loved, and I feel so lucky to have been born where I was at the intersection of great events and great people, never started a movement himself. He responded to the outcry and the welding up of anger and at the injustices. It was the Joanne Robinsons, the Fred Settlesworths in Birmingham, the poor people in Mississippi who created movements out of their need and their need for justice and their need to see a better life for our children. So the bottom line is we've got to have movement. Many people are trying to kick us backwards. We have got to move this country forward. I do not want my grandchildren fighting the same battles we fought. And we need to love our country and love our children enough to get out here and do what we've got to do. It is movement time. We do need a third Reconstruction era. And we've got to stop this backwards movement back, but that depends on you. So get out here and understand that you are the builders of movement and the transformation that we need, and I hope we'll get it going now. And you can do it. Thank you.
The Hutchins Center for African and African American Research supports research on the history and culture of people of African descent the world over and provides a forum for collaboration and the ongoing exchange of ideas. So begins the mission statement of this institution, one of Harvard's thriving international centers. Truly interdisciplinary, and working through many platforms, the Hutchins Center's work spans the breadth of the African diaspora and investigates every corner of it. Art is key to this endeavor, and one of the greatest supporters of the Hutchins Center's ongoing engagement with art as an expression of history and culture is Richard D. Cohen. CEO of Capital Properties Associates, the company he launched in 1977, Richard Cohen has given generously of his resources to support the Hutchins Center's growth as one of the preeminent centers for the study and exhibition of African and African American art in the country and in the world. Last year, on this occasion, we saw the opening of the Ethelbert Cooper Gallery of African and African American Art. It has housed three exhibitions and has rapidly become a major force in the art community at Harvard and beyond. With as keen an eye for art as he has for premier residential, hotel, and commercial properties, Richard Cohen has begun to build the permanent collection of the Cooper Gallery with four major pieces of contemporary art. You see images of them on the screen behind me. One of them is what you see now, Nick Cave's sound suit, Yinka Shonibari Food Fairy, Maria Magdalena Campos Pons' Sugar Bittersweet, and Peter Sachs' Aftermath. These pieces will be exhibited in the beautiful space of the Cooper Gallery at a later date. He has also contributed to the rich intellectual life of the Hutchins Center through the establishment of two programs: the Richard D. Cohen Fellowship in African and African American Art, which brings a scholar of art and art history to the center's renowned fellowship program, and the endowed Richard D. Cohen Lectures in African and African American Art. The lectureship brings a scholar or artist to deliver lectures on African diaspora art and art history at Harvard, which are then published by Yale University Press. Harvard's Hutchins Center is not the only beneficiary of his generosity. Cohen also is a major supporter of Boston University, his alma mater, and of programs such as Autism Speaks, the New York Public Library, and Job Path. The Hutchins Center has recognized his extraordinary contributions by naming him vice chair of the center's advisory board and chair of the Cooper Gallery. It is my great honor this afternoon to present Richard D. Cohen with the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal for all that he has done to build and sustain the academic mission of the Hutchins Center and the cultural life of the university community.
My friend, thank you. First, I want to thank Professor Gates and Mr. Hutchins for giving me not only the award, but a great forewarning of receiving the award, because I had no idea until I walked into the building tonight that I was receiving anything. And I think that was deliberate, so that I would keep it very short and have an excuse for being dumbfounded and quick. First, I'd like to say two things. First, what a thrill it is to be on the same stage with these people. I've had the thrill of going to an event that Skip does over the summers in Martha's Vineyard, which Charlayne Hunter-Gault typically MCs. And she doesn't know, you know, years ago I brought my daughter, who's now in her mid-20s, and I said, when you grow up, I hope you're like that woman, because she has just had such courage and done so much to make the world a better place. And that's the way I feel about this center. It is the epitome of what's good about higher learning, where you have people like Professor Gates and Larry Bobo, who I've gotten to know, where there is just an indoctrination to knowledge and understanding that makes people understand how they're more alike than they are different, and how that propagates it through the world in making us all better. So thank you. This means a lot.
Mm-hmm. I am reading a piece entitled Agitation, written by W.E.B. Du Bois and published in The Crisis in November 1910. Some good friends of the course, we represent fear agitation. They say, do not agitate, do not make noise, work. They add, agitation is distractive, or at best, negative. What is wanted is positive, constructive work. Such honest critics mistake the function of agitation. A toothache is agitation. Is a toothache a good thing? No. Is it therefore useless? No. It is supremely useful, for it tells the body of decay, dyspepsia, and death. Without it, the body would suffer unknowingly. It would think all is well when, lo, danger lurks. The same is true of the social body. Agitation is a necessary evil to tell of the ills of the suffering. Without it, many a nation has been lulled to false security and preened itself with virtues it did not possess. The function of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People is to tell this nation the crying evil of race prejudice. It is a hard duty, but a necessary one, a divine one. It is pain. Pain is not good, but pain is necessary. Pain does not aggravate disease. Disease causes pain. Agitation does not mean aggravation. Aggravation calls for agitation in order that remedy may be found.
Being featured in a lead article in Vanity Fair clearly establishes that you are a celebrity. But as Leo Browdy in his book, The Frenzy of Renown, Fame, and Its History reminds us, being a celebrity is a complicated thing. It invites acclaim, but can also invite envy or unfair criticism. Usually articles that have the title, Why the World Loves Mellody Hobson, are designed to build you up, and then somewhere in the article, take you down. Yet, this Vanity Fair reporter, who I imagine like most other investigative reporters, is trained to be a hard-boiled skeptic, had to conclude, and I quote, here's the thing about Hobson's remarkable life and all of this extravagant praise. It is earned. Mellody Hobson, the recipient I have the honor of introducing today, is truly a woman of amazing accomplishment and amazing grace. As president of Chicago-based Ariel Investment, Mellody Hobson is part of a leadership team of one of the largest and one of the few African-American-owned money management and mutual fund companies. She joined the company straight out of Princeton, where she graduated with a bachelor's degree from the Woodrow Wilson School of International Relations and Public Policy. At Ariel, she is responsible for strategic planning and management, and she serves as chairman of the Board of Trustees for Ariel Investment Trust. She led Ariel's 2002 launch of the Black Corporate Directors Conference, and she's spokesperson for the Ariel Black Investors Survey. Though Ariel's logo is the tortoise, in keeping with its slow but steady investment style, Hobson's rise has been rapid. In less than 10 years, she rose to become president of Ariel. Along the way, in addition to the brilliance she displayed in investing in and growing companies, the brilliance that earned her this elevated post, she also demonstrated her commitment to bringing financial literacy to all neighborhoods, not just the upper middle class enclaves that seem born into it. In the mid-1990s, she and John Rogers, the founder and CEO of Ariel Investments, founded Ariel Community Academy, a public school in the south side of Chicago that includes coursework on financial literacy. Her community involvement in Chicago and elsewhere has only expanded, and she chairs the nonprofit After School Matters and sits on the board of the Chicago Public Education Fund, the George Lucas Education Foundation, the Lucas Museum of Narrative Art, and the Sundance Institute. Hobson also serves on a lot of corporate boards, including chair of DreamWorks Animation SKG, and director of the Estee Lauder Companies and Starbucks Corporation. Named to the 2015 Time 100 list, the Route 100, the Wall Street Journal's 50 Women to Watch in 2008, and Ebony's 20 Leaders of the Future, all the way back in 1992, she has built a reputation based both on smart investing and straight talk about the racial disparities that characterize the world of finance and money. In a 2014 TED Talk, which if you haven't seen, I urge you all to do, entitled Color Blind or Color Brave, she asked her audience to show courage, to be bold. I'm asking you not to be color blind, but color brave, so that every child knows their future matters and their dreams are possible. She is one of the nation's foremost proponents of financial literacy training for African Americans, appearing on the CBS News, the Tom Joyner Morning Show, and in Black Enterprise Magazine. As the Vanity Fair article concluded, if there's anyone who can blow stereotypes to bits and get people to listen, it is Mellody Hobson. In the words of Senator Bill Bradley, a mentor of hers, she is, I quote, determined, disciplined, and enormously curious. These are the qualities that have fired her rise to the top and that also keep her focused on those who could, with the right knowledge and understanding, come up right after her. It is my deepest honor to present the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal to Mellody Hobson.
Let me know if this works. Is that okay with you, Jeff?
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I'm very proud of you.
Thank you.
So I have to start by saying that it's hard to sit next to Marian Wright Edelman and get an award, because my entire life, I've loved her. So I can't believe I'm sitting on the same stage with her. And I was overwhelmed with emotion. And she knows that. The good thing is she knows it because I've told her it before. So this isn't the first time. But when you sit here in Harvard and someone gives you an award sitting next to her, it's a bit overwhelming. I actually almost went to Harvard. I have to tell you this. I got into Harvard, and my mother, I was the only person in my family out of six, the youngest, oldest sister, 21 years older than me. My mother said, you have to go to Harvard. I got into Harvard and Princeton. And she said, Harvard is like Coca-Cola. You can go anywhere in the world, an African village, and say Coke, and people know what you're talking about. But Princeton is like Sprite. We only know it in America. I didn't go to Harvard, and I met a person when I went to Princeton who changed my life, and that's John Rogers, who is here. I've had one job since I graduated from college almost 25 years ago, and it's because of John. John had the foresight to start our firm. And when I went there to be a summer intern when I was 19 years old, I realized at that moment I would sit next to him and work next to him for the rest of my life. I know that's hard to imagine, especially in a day and age where the average American has 11 jobs in their lifetime, but it's true. And I think my calling came naturally. I heard someone this weekend say, "You don't pick your passions pick you." My passions were born out of my circumstances of growing up in a home where we were often evicted and our phone got disconnected and our lights got turned off. And I was desperate to understand money. And so I went and worked in the money management business, but with a person who was a pioneer. John had the good fortune of having his father, who was a Tuskegee Airman, give him stocks every birthday and every Christmas starting when he was 12 years old, instead of toys. In the beginning, he said it wasn't very fun. But that childhood hobby turned into a passion that turned into our company. And in so doing, in building the first minority-owned money management company in the nation, I found this place. And I quickly realized that when I would go and speak to audiences and we would go around and do meetings, there weren't a lot of people who looked like us. And we quickly realized maybe there was a void in that this idea of being a participant, an active participant in capitalism in this society, where you have the opportunity to create wealth, to pass on that wealth to your family, to have a secure and successful life in retirement, to be able to send your kids to schools like this, all of that maybe wasn't as obvious to our community as it should be, and hence was born this calling of financial literacy, first and foremost for people of color, and then more broadly. And I have to say it's been a calling that I've been just so fulfilled in doing. People always ask me, why do I work on television? I run an investment firm, but I work on television, including today and yesterday, so that I can teach people. And I can teach them about money and hopefully help them make better decisions. I'll close by saying that lately I've been talking a lot about being brave. And one of the reasons I was so honored to be here is because when I think of brave, I think of Professor Gates, I think of Glenn Hutchins, who's a business hero. I think of so many people who've come through Harvard, but I think of W.E.B. Du Bois. In a speech I recently gave, I talked about a letter that I have sitting on my desk from W.E.B. Du Bois, which was a letter he sent to his daughter when he was sending her to boarding school in Europe in her young teens. I think she was 13 years old. And in the letter, he tells her she's going to go to this unknown world, and people are going to be very curious about her, he says, especially her crinkly hair. But he tells her, take the cold bath bravely. And I think about that a lot. And I think about that in terms of the work I do every single day and what we can do to move the needle for the people in our community, our African-American community, and our broader community. Take the cold bath bravely. The bath can be terribly cold at times, but we really must be brave, all of us. So thank you so much. And again, I'm deeply, deeply humbled and honored to receive this award.
It is a thrill and a humbling privilege to be able to participate in the honoring of one of my heroes, Carrie Mae Weems. We live in a world awash in photographs, but very few people make great works of photography. To do so requires a profound understanding of history and what, in a given moment, history requires, what we need from it, and for whom. And making photography requires that rare capacity to communicate this understanding through something merely visible. Carrie Mae Weems has time and again shown such an understanding and such a capacity. Over time, her work has distinguished itself by exquisitely balancing critique and celebration, clarity and ambiguity, performance and revelation, word and image, historical record, and everyday experience. And if any of my students from my undergraduate course have taken that down, you can use those notes later on. The upper reaches of the art world remain very male and very pale. And against long odds, Ms. Weems has won great distinction. She has had nearly 50 solo exhibitions at museums and galleries, including the Whitney Museum of Art, the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis, the International Center for Photography, the National Museum of Women in the Arts, and at the Hutchins Center's Rudenstein Gallery, as well as venues in London, Berlin, and Dakar. Her work has also been featured in numerous important group exhibitions, including Afro-Modern, Journeys Through the Black Atlantic, which was at Tate Liverpool in 2010, and Posing Beauty, African-American Images from the 1980s to the Present, curated by the inimitable Deborah Willis. So great have been Ms. Weems' achievements that in 2008, New York Times art critic Helen Cotter complained, "I don't know why Carrie Mae Weems hasn't had a mid-career museum retrospective. No American photographer of the last quarter century has turned out a more probing, varied, and moving body of work." In 2012, the Frist Center for the Visual Arts in Nashville responded to Cotter's challenge with the retrospective Carrie Mae Weems' Three Decades of Photography and Video. And as an aficionado of the still image, I emphasize the still photographs, but the current work, I know, is doing fabulous things in video. A year after the retrospective, Ms. Weems received a phone call from the MacArthur Foundation confirming what we already knew, namely that she's a genius. As perhaps no other artist of her generation, Ms. Weems has understood the weight of history. Hers is a brilliance that opens out onto the world, that inspires it, that enlarges the scope of our understanding and our commitment, that gives us a way to appreciate and approach the brilliance and beauty of others. And how appropriate that she recently designed with a landscape architect the Du Bois peony to anchor the Du Bois Memorial Garden at the University of Massachusetts Amherst. In one of my favorite of her series, Museums, Ms. Weems stands back to the viewer before the facades of major cultural institutions, from the Pergamon Museum in Berlin to the Philadelphia Museum of Art. Her body, clothed in a dark dress, stands out against the white neoclassical pillars before it, setting the courageous dignity of her presence against the monumental exclusions of the past and their ongoing legacy. Today, in this neo-Gothic edifice, we welcome Ms. Weems into the interior of Harvard, as we have welcomed her work into the interior of our hearts and minds, to award her the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal in recognition of her extraordinary achievements.
What an honor. I am just... I didn't know that by naming the a peony for my great Du Bois, so that one could have hope growing in their garden every day, would lead to this. I'll just say just one thing. I was so excited when I learned that I would be given this award with my esteemed colleagues and along with our great, 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 great Muhammad Ali. And it reminded me recently of something that I read a few years ago. I was reading Sugar Ray Robinson. Sugar Ray was talking about Muhammad Ali, that great, great, great sort of contest between these two extraordinary boxers, fighters, men of the ring. And Sugar Ray said of Muhammad Ali, as he stood back in his life and reflected on his life and what it meant, he said, I came to realize that I was a boxer and Muhammad Ali was history. Skip Gates, the Hutchins Center is history. Thank you.
Last year, my dear friend Skip Gates stood on this stage to introduce us to the newest addition to the Hutchins Center family, the Ethelbert Cooper Gallery of African and African American Art. At the time, he said, "The mission of the Cooper Gallery is to create a place where the art and artists of the African diaspora are at home and in constant movement, where voices are heard in both startling clarity and productive cacophony, and where creativity and artwork combine to lift the veil on the fullest range of Black artistic sensibilities, creating extraordinary moments of beauty and illumination in stunning visual dialogue. I'm pleased to report that over the past 12 months, the Cooper Gallery has done just that. It has become a destination for art lovers, for scholars, for students, and for people just passing by its prime location on Mount Auburn Street. And for the wonders of the Cooper Gallery And for the wonders that the Cooper Gallery has brought to Harvard, to Cambridge, and to the country, we have one man to thank, Ethelbert Cooper, who is here with us this afternoon. 1 year after its opening, Bert has finally had the chance to visit, in person, the gallery that bears his name. I'm told that he liked what he saw. Yes? Yes, good. Ethelbert Cooper is the principal founder of Afrin PLC, a London-based oil and gas exploration production with assets across Africa and the Middle East. Already a leader in Africa's natural resources sector, he is now at the forefront of the effort to facilitate Chinese participation in that sector and in Africa's economy. As successful as he is in industry, he is even more impressive as a leader on social issues. Bert is a founding member and chairman of the Liberian International Development Foundation, a founder of the US-based African American Foundation, and a member of the President's Council of International Advisors at Yale University. At Yale, where he earned his BA in economics in 1974, Bert sponsors a scholarship fund for African students and advises the university on conferences aimed to enhance understanding of China-Africa relations. If you haven't visited the Cooper Gallery, you should. Through Bert's generosity, the Hutchins Center has built a world-class art gallery for the study an exhibition of African and African American art. A truly amazing exhibition space established by a truly amazing man. It's my great honor to present Ethelbert Cooper with the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal in recognition of his foresight, his engagement, and his dedication to sharing African and African American art with the Harvard community and the world beyond.
Thank you. Congratulations. I see that I've been handed my prepared text, but I shall basically dispense with it by first saying that I was talking to Glenn downstairs, and he said to me, "You know, this was a surprise, and we wanted to be sure you showed up this time because last year when you opened the gallery, you were in China." And so I said, "Well," he said, "let's make sure, because if we didn't tell this guy 3 days before the event, he may not show up, and therefore we'll be celebrating the event without him. So thank you for forewarning me and giving me the chance to be here, Glenn. First of all, let me just say that this gallery, actually, I always would like to give first and foremost recognition to Skip Gates. Skip is Skip's idea, and it's a gallery which effectively has done amazingly well in 1 year, but it has been a dream that Skip had in his heart, and effectively I benefited from reflecting that in terms of what we've been able to do with it. Skip and I go back a long ways, and you know, it's very interesting, our history has a way of actually making an impact. When we were at Yale, Skip in fact was in this rather secret society called Book and Snake, which of course is one of two rather bizarre societies at Yale, the other one being Skull and Bones. But these names, of course, Skip was a member and was graduating in 73. And I was a junior about to basically move on, and Skip asked me to replace him because the usual tradition is that seniors select juniors to replace them. And so I replaced Skip in A Book and Snake. Of course, that has heavy responsibility because he signed me up recently to give a new table to Book and Snake, which is a gigantic table in the basement of the society, which he and I are going to celebrate and dedicate in November. But more to the point, Skip and I had a rather interesting meeting here in Boston some years back when he planted the idea, and we went down to this rather bizarre place. I thought it was a little bit strange. I said, "Skip, you sure this place can be a gallery? Can be built in this place?" He said, Yes, it's okay, we've got enough space here. I said, "Man, look, I don't believe that this place is the right place, but let's give it a try." And Skip persevered, and of course, Dean Smith was very, very good at supporting the exercise. And so we were able to build this wonderful new gallery here at Harvard. I must say that the most important thing about it is that it is reflecting what is so important to me, which is that the expression of Africa and African identity in the American context and beyond. You know, I'm a keen believer in Africa. I come from the continent. I come from a little country called Liberia. And there's a very interesting admixture between Liberia and Du Bois. Du Bois was, in fact, rather interestingly sent to Liberia in the 1920s as a special envoy of the US president to the inauguration of President King, Liberian President King. And he had the occasion to then, of course, get quite enraptured by what this country could do. And he effectively then engaged a gentleman called Harvey Firestone, the founder of the Firestone Group, and made a big effort to get Firestone to invest in Liberia. In fact, I sent Skip a letter that Du Bois wrote to Firestone, and I must say, I thought he may have had a computer because this letter was so well written and well typed. But it was a 3-page letter he wrote to Mr. Firestone, outlining his reasons why he should make the investment, but more importantly, elaborating on how he should conduct his affairs, how he should hire people, how he should train Africans, how he should give Africans a chance to be important and contributing forces in the exercise. And so I said to Skip, I said, you know, Du Bois' intersection with us in Liberia is a very important one because that project, Firestone, became the largest rubber plantation in the world. It actually was a major strategic factor in the supply of the Allies during World War II. For rubber supply, of course, you need lots of rubber tires and so forth for the Allied forces. And so that particular project today remains. Even after all these tumultuous events in Liberia, it still stands as an important legacy to the economy of Liberia. And this is all because Du Bois had tremendous vision. He was a man who, of course, is known for his taste, his intellectual fervor, his love for the good things of life. Of course, he distinguished himself as the first PhD here at Harvard. But African-American PhD, of course. But more importantly, he was a man who had a great vision. And I remember telling my kids all the time, to master your destiny, you must have a destiny to master. It is important that you plan. It's important that you basically have a vision about where you want to go. Destination planning is the key to success. I'm not here to lecture you great people at Harvard because everybody here is a keen intellectual. But it's important to say that what we've done here with the gallery is a vision. It's a vision that has been made real because one man had the vision, another man basically helped to reinforce it, myself, and ultimately we have the result of the vision today here on the campus. And that vision effectively shows you that if you want something in this world, if you plan for it, if you work towards achieving it, you can make it happen. And so we are very, very grateful to Harvard for actually supporting and hosting this. We are grateful to all of the honorees here tonight because, of course, as I said to Skip, I'm a simple African businessman. You know, I'm not in the social galaxy of these great American heroes. But nonetheless, I think in our own little way, we try to basically project an important message that Africa, and I like the notion, Black lives matter, African lives matter. We today live in a world where Africa is the center many times of discussion. We have a continent which is riveted by all kinds of socio-political and economic issues, but nonetheless, it's a continent which probably is the fastest growing continent economically in the world today. It has a lot of potential. We actually are very active in a number of spaces in Africa in the business world. But you know, we always believe that our first and foremost objective is to project African capability and African can-do. Because in truth, there is a notion that we need to basically import everything into Africa. Everybody must come and help Africa. Africa is in need of help. And we'd like to basically change that notion. Africa is a continent that can help itself. There are many Africans who are doing great things, who are bringing new achievements to the continent, and we actually need to basically celebrate those people. I'm glad to see that increasingly, Charlayne Hunter-Gault, formerly worked for CNN, they have in fact built up a huge sort of number of programs in support of Africa's sort of sail to the world, bringing Africa to the world. And we effectively believe that a gallery like this at Harvard helps to concretize the bond between in this diaspora, this African-American and African fusion that we need to keep building on. Because in truth, like Du Bois said, 10 million people were sent over here to begin a new life. And of course, these people came from one place. They all came from Africa. So we are very grateful that we have this occasion today to be able to receive this honor. I mean, I was totally surprised. Kip wrote me a note last week and said, you must come, you must come. I said, okay, all right. We shall be here this time. Last year I was in China when Mrs. Cooper and my daughter, who are here with me tonight, came and were here for the opening of the gallery. Tonight I'm very pleased to be here, and I would like to thank Skip, Glenn, President Faust, and I'd like to say well done to all the other honorees here tonight. We are very, very pleased, and we accept this honor, but we're humbled by it, and we want to just leave the message that Africa is here, and Africa will do better, and Africa can do better. And we thank you very much for this honor.
Good evening. I'm Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham. I will be reading from Du Bois and from his book, Dark Water. I arise at 7. The milkman has neglected me. He pays little attention to colored districts. The children jeer as I pass to work. The women in the streetcar withdraw their skirts or prefer to stand. The policeman is truculent. The elevator man hates to serve Negroes. My job is insecure because the white union wants it and does not want me. I enter the free field of science. Every laboratory door is closed and no endowments are available. I seek the universal mistress, art. The studio door is locked. I write literature. We cannot publish stories of colored folks of that type. It's the only type I know. This is my life. It makes me idiotic. It gives me artificial problems. They do happen. Not all each day, surely not. But now and then, now seldom, now sudden, now after a week, now in a chain of awful minutes. Not everywhere, but anywhere in Boston, in Atlanta. Imagine spending your life looking for insults or for hiding places from them, shrinking instinctively from blows that are not always, but ever, not each day, but each week, each month, each year. No more tickets downstairs. Here's one to the smoking gallery. You hesitate. You beat back your suspicions, after all. Then a white man pushes by. Three in the orchestra, please. Yes, sir. And in he goes. Suddenly, your heart chills. You turn yourself away toward the golden twinkle of the purple night and hesitate again. What's the use? Why not always yield, always take what's offered, always bow to force? Then the great fear surges in your soul, the fear, the real fear, beside which other fears are vain imaginings. The fear lest right there and then you are losing your own soul, that you are losing your own soul and the soul of a people, that millions of unborn children, black and gold and mauve, are being there and then despoiled by you because you are a coward and dared not fight. Suddenly, that silly orchestra ticket, that silly orchestra seat, becomes matters of life and death and immortality. You grasp the pillars of the universe and strain as you sway back to that ticket girl. You grip your soul, you choke and sputter, and she, seeing that you are about to make a fuss, obeys the orders and throws the tickets at you in contempt. Then you slink to your seat and crouch in the darkness before the film, with every tissue burning. The miserable wave of reaction engulfs you. To think, forcing your way among cheap and tawdry idiots. God, what a night of pleasure.
It is my great privilege to present the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal to Charlayne Hunter-Gault, an icon of the civil rights movement and a renowned journalist. Born in the town of Due West in South Carolina and raised in Georgia, the heart of the old Confederacy and of Jim Crow, Charlayne dreamt of becoming a journalist, inspired, she says, by the comic strip Brenda Starr, which featured a female reporter with an adventure-filled life. When she was a star student at Atlanta's Turner High, Charlayne and her classmate Hamilton Holmes were approached by Constance Baker Motley and Vernon Jordan in their search for just the right students who, in their judgment, were well-suited to the rigorous challenge of integrating Georgia's state university system. Charlayne and Hunter, both of whom were at the top of their high school class and possessed of uncommon ambition, seized the opportunity. But Charlayne, who we've come to know well, characteristically insisted on enrolling not at Georgia State in Atlanta, but rather at the University of Georgia, which had an excellent journalism program. In 1959, 5 years after the Supreme Court's decision in Brown v. Board, her application was rejected by the university because of limited space. Who do they think they are, Harvard? But she applied every quarter for the next 2 years until Motley and Jordan finally convinced the federal court to compel her, the university, to accept her. With all of America watching on the nightly news, she was greeted upon her arrival in 1961 in Athens, Georgia, in the company of Vernon Jordan, by a terrifying riot, fomented by a violent mob but abetted by hostile university leaders, unfriendly local police, and deeply resistant fellow students. The university promptly suspended her for her own safety, a move which was protested by 300 brave faculty members at the University of Georgia in 1961, but which necessitated another court order to overturn. For Charlayne, retreat was not an option. In reflecting on that time, she has said, quote, "If you retreat to remove struggle from your life, you are very mistaken. It's not over. It may never be over. But I find joy in that struggle." Hunter-Gault has fought that joyous struggle throughout her career. After becoming the first African-American reporter for The New Yorker, she went on to The New York Times, where she was one of the first black reporters and where she established the Harlem Bureau. In that capacity, she forced a path-breaking change to the paper's editorial policy. She wrote a blunt memorandum to her bosses, challenging the practice of white editors to use the descriptor Negro instead of black in articles. Within days, management followed her lead, and for the newspaper of record, Negro became black. Reflecting on that landmark change, she has said, quote, "Nowadays it seems almost silly, but it was one of those defining moments in the history of black journalism in white institutions." There have been a number of those defining moments for Hunter-Gault. In her work as a journalist, she achieved well-deserved fame on television during her nearly 20 years on the McNeil-Lehrer NewsHour on PBS. She worked afterwards at CNN's Johannesburg bureau chief and as a special correspondent for National Public Radio based in South Africa. She recently returned to PBS and is now leading the NewsHour series Race Matters, a year-long conversation about finding solutions to the, and I quote, "painful reality that America's deepest wound is far from healed," unquote. Charlayne became a giant in her profession, a real-life Brenda Starr, garnering 2 Emmy Awards and 2 Peabody Awards, among other major journalism awards. In 1988, she returned to Athens as the first African-American to deliver the commencement address at the University of Georgia, where students rioted, this time to get her autograph. Her memoir, In My Place, is essential reading for any study of the civil rights movement. She writes, quote, "You know, it was almost like a double existence. On the one hand, I was a subject of the news, people covering me. On the other hand, I was watching them watching me." This unique perspective, reminiscent of W.E.B. Du Bois himself, became the tool of her trade and a powerful message to her admiring audience. On a personal note, Charlayne is a good friend, both to Harvard and to my family. Every summer, she makes time from her busy schedule to host the Hutchins Center's Forum on Martha's Vineyard, after which we always have a good meal and occasionally get to sample some of her husband's fine South African wine. So it is a personal thrill for me today to honor my pal, Charlayne. With great admiration and deep respect, I present Charlayne Hunter-Gault the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal.
Thank you. Glenn and I are usually drinking wine, so I just asked him, where did you get all that stuff? First of all, let me say that
I accept this amazing honor in the name of the other lawyer who was on our team, Donald Hollowell, the late Donald Hollowell, and in memory of our most recent loss, the great civil rights crusader, along with Marian, Julian Bond. I also accepted in the appreciation of the man Glenn referred to, my husband Ron Gault, last month, my husband of 44 years, an additional three that we won't talk about, my best critic most of the time, my enduring supporter in good times and in bad. But I think at this moment it would be appropriate to actually say thank you to all of you. But one of the things I learned on my amazing life's journey that would make Brenda Starr eat her heart out at this point is that the reason you should be thanking yourself, yourselves at this time, all of you. For while working and living in South Africa, I learned a word that comes to mind when receiving an honor like this. And the word is Ubuntu. Ubuntu. And it means I am who I am because you are, Evelyn, who you are. And that applies to my fellow honorees, from whom I draw limitless inspiration. I mean, I Googled all of you before I got here, even though I knew a lot about some of you. Even from one as young as Nas, I draw inspiration from you, good brother. From the older, slightly older generation, Glenn and Skip, and all those, just slightly, Skip just had his, you know what, birthday. Reminded me the next day when I had forgotten. True. But also all of you at the Hutchins Institute, all of you who are tireless in your pursuit of keeping our history alive and relevant through, among other things, occasions like this. So as the song goes, we are family. The same family, biological, my mother who is in heaven with Julian, and my brother Chuck, who is here tonight on earth with his wife Teresa, and the extended family that prepared me for my life's journey many years before I went to South Africa and learned from people like Nelson Mandela and Desmond Tutu and everyday people, the value they lived was Ubuntu. But Ubuntu by another name was why I learned at an early age about W.E.B. Du Bois. From folks who, due to the segregated world I grew up in, couldn't give their children first-class citizenship, but they gave us something even more important. They gave us a first-class sense of ourselves, especially teaching us our proud history. They taught me that I am who I am because of people like W.E.B. Du Bois and the great crusading journalist Ida B. Wells, who lit the path I have traveled for the past 50 some odd years. You know, I had an opportunity to reflect on all of those lessons in the aftermath of the Charleston tragedy, as I listened to a family member who said that she forgave the murderer. And while some of the younger generation, Nas, didn't understand that, I did. For I knew that forgiveness was about their own internal healing, and it didn't preclude the pursuit of justice, right, Eric Holder? And while I'm sure that other denominations provided the same lessons, mine came from the same church as the denomination at Charleston's Mother Emmanuel. Mother Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church, one of the oldest in the country. And those value-laden lessons, for me, form layers of armor that helped me traverse the territory Du Bois called our two-ness, to which I, with the permission of Dr. Gates, have added what I'm sure in this day and age Du Bois would have added too, and that is not just the two-ness, but the three-ness. Not only as an American and the term he used in those days and as a Negro, with two unreconciled strivings in one dark body. As an American, though, for me, as an American, a Negro, in Du Bois' words, and a woman, right, Marian, Carrie, Mellody? But over time, I have seen those strivings narrow, though not completely, as we heard from Skip this morning, this afternoon, reconciled. And that is what keeps me keeping on. Even Nas, at the tender age of 73, know what I'm saying? Richard Cohen knows what I'm saying, although he's not close to me either. But another lesson I learned from those like Martin Luther King was the need not only to embrace the beloved community in our own country, but also the global community, as you've just heard from my good brother here abroad, Africa and the entire rest of the world. And therefore, as I've always pursued my profession, in the forefront of my mind were those who would otherwise have no voice. But for my pen, my microphone, my camera, or my podium. And to this day, far too many of those who have no voice are women. Women as weapons of war, where they are being raped in places like the Congo and South Sudan, or northern Nigeria in the path of Boko Haram, or elsewhere in the grip of ISIL, or the gay women in South Africa who are being raped to correct their sexual orientation and often viciously murdered. And this recognition today will serve to keep me remembering them in the hope that one day, some of them can stand at a podium like this with this amazing piece of history and speak themselves of Ubuntu, so that those women who are today not privileged to be where we are, so that they can one day stand at this podium and speak of Ubuntu, and so they can say, I am who I am, and have gotten to where I am wearing this medal because you are who you are. Thank you.
It is my honor to present the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal to legendary hip-hop artist Nasir Jones, known to the world simply as Nas. part poet, entrepreneur, intellectual, metaphysician, wordsmith, Nas is widely considered one of the greatest hip-hop artists of all time. When we recall that hip-hop began in the early 1970s in economically depressed areas of metropolitan New York, all time assumes a significance that isn't empty boasting. Hip-hop has a history, and Nas is a major part of it. Illmatic was Nas's first album, released in 1994 to near universal critical acclaim. The Source magazine, which was started here at Harvard University, awarded Illmatic a rare 5 mics, the highest possible rating. Harvard philosopher Tommy Shelby writes that at the age of 18, Nas presented an uncanny mix of politically conscious lyrics juxtaposed with an honest hardcore sensibility. The Village Voice also gave him serious praise, calling him, quote, one of the most important writers of the 20th century, end quote. Nas is a phenomenally successful artist, having amassed 8 consecutive platinum and multi-platinum records, having sold on over 25 million records worldwide since 1994. His albums are lyrical ethnographies, wherein the plight of urban life is simultaneously chastised and romanticized. His lyrics go beyond autobiography to explore politics, family, religion, and race, and his music draws on jazz and other music styles. Whether it be from his father, Oludara, a successful jazz and blues trumpeter, or the pounding bass from the boomboxes outside in the courtyards of the Queensbridge housing projects of his youth, music was a central component to Nas's upbringing from early on. Combine that with the love of language and books instilled in him by his father, it is easy to see how the young Nas was destined to become an intellectual at heart. His world was one of extreme incongruities, the coldness of the streets versus the warmth of his mother's love. Life as a middle school dropout, juxtaposed against the recognition and the power of words and ideas to escape the harsh realities of life in Queensbridge. Yet it was his ability to navigate these incongruities with a critical consciousness that resonates so loudly in his music and work. Nas's relationship with Harvard began before today. This campus is full of Nas philosophers, musicians, educators, scientists, historians, athletes, writers, and more who quote his lyrics and are energized to work at the highest possible level and to build the world we want, need, and deserve, and that he imagined. In 2014, an anonymous donor funded the Nasir Jones Hip Hop Fellowship at the Hip Hop Archive and Research Institute of the Hutchins Center. The fellowship allows us to bring people to the Hip Hop Archive who are doing work that has to do with the ways hip hop itself reaches out to youth throughout the world, and particularly how it brings together issues of social justice, art, and politics. In another connection with Harvard, Lisa New of the Department of English has prominently featured Nas in work she's doing on poetry for American teachers with the Graduate School of Education. And he will be the focus of a WGBH episode of her Poetry in America. Nas's commitment to stay true to his worldview is extraordinary in popular culture. However, as important as his message is, Nas layers his lyrics with mysticism, challenging one to think even further to uncover the meaning behind his rhymes. There is no silver platter. You cannot grasp his message in a passive listen. One of the most striking moments in the film Time is Illmatic, which was released on the 20th anniversary of the album and gives us rich images to fill out the story told on that classic album, is when the film ends with Nas walking through the door of the Hip Hop Archive. This arrival illustrates what the film's producer, Eric Parker, said, quote, "It's an amazing story that showed us that Nas's journey isn't just about music, it's an American story," end quote. This multifaceted artist is still on that journey, and we will go along with him. It is my great honor to present the E.B. Du Bois Medal to Nasir Jones.
Thank you. Love you too. Oh man, this is surreal. I want to thank thank you. I want to thank Glenn and Skip Gates and Drew and everyone here and all of you, for making me honoree with the rest of these great people. And hip hop music is a thing that's misunderstood a lot. And I'm one of the fans from the old school that remembers like Run DMC and the Fat Boys and Houdini and Curtis Blow, and remember traveling to the Bronx and just seeing this art form and wishing that one day it would get acknowledged and the respect that it was due. And it's gone to huge heights at this point, but this is a level that hip hop hasn't really come to fully, being acknowledged by this setting right here, which is cool. This is the thing that I want kids to see. They see award shows, they see videos that just promote money and fun, but these are the things that the kids need to see, the real things. This is a light that I like on me. This is what I hope kids from my neighborhood can see and want to be. I hope that I can be a great role model for those kids, because there's not enough education being pumped into kids in a form, in a way that is cool. We make everything cool. Like, this chain is real cool. I might wear it to the club. This is cool. No, I respect this chain too much for the club. But this is a great honor. I appreciate you, Skip. I remember I met Skip with my friend Ben Horowitz, and it was a great gathering of people for dinner. And one of the people there was the creator of MTV. And we all talked about, what we did for a living, and, it was a good group of people. And at one point, the guy, forget his name, he created MTV, he was talking, and Skip jumped up and yelled, "Why'd it take too long to put black people on MTV, man?" Right there, he became my man. Yo, I wanna, thank Mr. Du Bois. I think he's here in the room with us. And I wanna thank Moms, rest in peace. And I wanna thank my pops for when I was reading Superman and stuff. He gave me comic books about African-American history, and changed my life. And I was self-taught, I like to think. I was given books by my parents, but I wouldn't read them until I was bored and I was forced to read them. And I said, let's kill this boredom. And I read about so much rich, great history that I didn't learn in school. And it made me write it into my music here and there. Not too much, just enough so I don't back people up, but just enough so that you know where I'm coming from and know that I had something to say about my people and the great history that we come from. It's just mind-blowing to just think, like, dang, we didn't know, there's a Dogon tribe who knew the constellation and the stars, They knew all this stuff, and the pyramids that were in dark Nubia, Africa, where the whole Egyptian thing began, and then the whole history of our people is just so incredible that it just blew me away, and I couldn't wait to share it in my music piece by piece. And it turns out that somebody heard those little pieces I put in there, and it kept me around for 20 years, and I'm grateful, hopefully, that the kids see that you can be more than just the image, the typical image of rap. You could take it to beyond the stars and the skies and the universe, man. You could do whatever you want to do in this country. I'm standing on the shoulders of my ancestors every way. And thank you, Mr. Du Bois. I know you're in the room, and salute these people here. Peace.
Good evening. I am honored to be here today to celebrate the life, the accomplishments, the contributions of a truly extraordinary human being. Someone who, as Glenn Hutchins said before today, is really one of a kind, is really unique, and someone who needs no introduction, not here, not anywhere in the world, for that matter, Mr. Muhammad Ali. Poetry in motion. The phrase is familiar, but our final medalist has brought life to it for 5 decades. The 56 wins, the 37 knockouts, the rumble in the jungle, the thriller in Manila, and other fights of the century, which are legendary, and the meaning and the power of his words, which have stayed with us. In the figure of Muhammad Ali, poetry in motion becomes both art and action. It is the 40th anniversary to the day of the thriller in Manila, widely considered one of the best fights in boxing history. Sports Illustrated is marking the occasion by placing Ali on its cover for the 39th time, but more profoundly, by renaming its Legacy Award the Sports Illustrated Muhammad Ali Legacy Award, an honor given to athletes whose dedication to the ideals of sportsmanship has spanned decades and whose career in sports has had a direct impact on the world. Ali's impact on the world has been sustained, and it has been unique. On presenting Ali with the inaugural Gromeyer Spirit Award 2 weeks ago, in honor of his Making the World a Better Place, Huffington Post Global News editor Howard Fineman said, I quote, decades before Black Lives Matter, Ali shouted that very idea to people who often did not want to hear it. Indeed, his breathtaking gold medal performance in the 1960 Summer Olympics in Rome made the young Cassius Clay a familiar figure to the American public, not all of whom were charmed by his unmitigated and uncensored confidence. He used words as powerfully as his fists, and in so doing, Clay, who publicly changed his name, as you know, and announced his adherence to the Nation of Islam in 1964, after winning the heavyweight title, made many people uncomfortable. The white establishment in the sporting world and beyond distrusted his religion as militant separatism and heard his ringside poetry as at best bragging and at worst stepping out of his place. He made the American establishment furious with his rejection of the draft in 1967, his outspoken criticism of the war in Vietnam, and his insistence that his own country could do better in serving the needs of its own people, all of its people. I don't have to be what you want me to be. I am free to be who I want, Ali said the day after winning the heavyweight title for the first time. Through his self-possession and self-fashioning, Ali certainly did step out of the lines drawn for him as a black man in the 1960s. David Remnick, who wrote the magisterial Ali biography, King of the World, Muhammad Ali and the Rise of an American Hero, put it this way, I quote, "As an athlete, he was supposed to remain aloof from the racial and political upheaval going on around him. Clay not only responded to the upheaval, but responded in a way that outraged everyone, from the White Citizens Council to the leaders of the NAACP. He changed his religion and his name. He declared himself free." Ali's path anticipated the path the country would follow. The drama of Ali's refusal to be drafted, the stripping of his title and his profession, his conviction for draft evasion, and the overturning of that conviction by the U.S. Supreme Court played out against the backdrop of a drop in national support for the war in Vietnam, and also a slowly emerging change in the understanding of what race means and how it matters. Where he had once been seen as a traitor for resisting the draft, and as a dangerous rebel for refusing to be the black man that white America thought he should be, he came to be seen not only as right, but also as a hero. He was invited to the White House in 1974. He lit the Olympic torch in Atlanta in 1996, and he received the Presidential Medal of Freedom in 2005. In celebration of the 50th anniversary of Muhammad Ali's career, in 2009, President Obama wrote, I quote, "The quality of Ali's that I have always admired the most are his unique ability to summon extraordinary strength and courage in the face of adversity, to navigate the storm and never lose his way. We admire the man who has never stopped using his celebrity for good." For years, he continued to speak out for racial justice, for religious toleration, for peace. Ali and his wife, Loni, have carried on his legacy of truth-telling and self-respect through their establishment of the Muhammad Ali Center in Louisville with the motto, "Be great, do great things." The Ali Center is built on the foundation of Ali's six core principles: confidence, conviction, dedication, giving, respect, and spirituality. For the artistry of his movement and the poetry of his fists, for his fearless stance in the fight that mattered most, and for embodying the power of art and action, the Hutchins Center recognizes Muhammad Ali with the W.E.B. Du Bois Medal. And because the greatest can be with us in person tonight, the Ali Center has produced a film especially for us. Ladies, gentlemen, Mr. Muhammad Ali.
Greatest.
'Cause you found
You can run the mile, you can walk straight through hell with a smile. You could be the hero, you could get the gold. Breaking all the records they thought never could be broke. Yeah, do it for your people, do it for your pride. And you're never gonna know if you never even try. Do it for your country, do it for your name. Cause there's gonna be a day when you're standing in the hall of fame. But Muhammad Ali is not just a man's name. It's a prayer. It's a whisper, a chant, a rallying cry, a trumpet call. It's a challenge to be the best we can be. And the world's gonna know your name. Yeah. And you'll be on the walls of the Hall of Fame.
Can I dance? Is the Pope a Catholic?
I'm a poet, I'm a prophet, I'm the resurrector, I'm the savior of the boxing world.
Good evening, and thank you all for being here this evening with us. We're sorry we can't be there with you, but we really appreciate the opportunity to be able to accept this wonderful award here at the Ali Center in Louisville, Kentucky. Thank you, Dr. Gates, Hutchins Center, Harvard University, and congratulations to all of the other awardees this evening. This is very special, this medal, the W.E.B. Du Bois medal being given to Muhammad. Muhammad, I think, like Dr. Du Bois, was a very enlightened individual from the very beginning. I've known Muhammad since I was 6. At the age of 22, Muhammad was enlightened enough to be able to speak the truth and recognize the truth and always represent the truth, regardless of what others thought. Throughout his life, he's fought for people who were not able to fight for themselves. He was always the voice for the underdog, those who were oppressed, and he always fought for social justice for everyone, regardless of color, religion, or creed, or political persuasion. He always recognized when people were being oppressed and injustices occurred in society, and he did not fear the establishment of being able to speak out and to represent people in the best light. Muhammad, even though today we have come far and many accomplishments have been made, progress has been made, we still recognize there's lots to be done. And even though this medal is a wonderful accolade and sort of a punctuation into Muhammad's life of things that he has accomplished, it is by no means the end or the period to what needs to be done or what he intends to do. Even though Muhammad has slowed down some, he's still very active, believe it or not. He realizes that the fight must go on. And even though he may not be able to carry on that fight himself, he passes that torch on to others, which is why we have the Ali Humanitarian Awards. But thank you very much for the medal, for the W.E.B. Du Bois acknowledgement. And we hope that we are able to live up to everything that Dr. Du Bois stood for and continues to stand for in his legacy. And hopefully the Ali legacy will be just as bright. Thank you.
What a phenomenally inspiring evening. I feel like I can float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. I am the greatest. But please join me in saluting these 2015 W.E.B. Du Bois honorees. Are truly extraordinary gifts to us and to the world. On behalf of President Faust, Glenn Hutchins, and Henry Louis Gates Jr., we'd like to thank you for joining us in this special occasion. In closing, I want to leave you with words of benediction from W.E.B. Du Bois as we prepare to enjoy one more selection from the Kuumba Singers. Give us grace, O God, to dare to do the deed which we well know cries to be done. Let us not hesitate because of ease or the words of men's mouths or our own lives. Mighty causes are calling us. The freeing of women, the training of children, the putting down of hate and murder and poverty, all these and more. But they call with voices that mean work and sacrifice. And so, Lord, help us to leave this place appreciative of all that you have done through these great men and women, and more committed and energized for the labor ahead. Amen.
Thank you. Give it up one more time for the Kuumba singers, please. Okay. That concludes our program, ladies and gentlemen. Good night. But before you say good night, give it up one more time for the 2015 Du Bois medalists. Good night. God bless.